Good evening, everyone. Welcome you all to the TechGig webinar. Thank you for joining the session today. The topic of today's talk is Industrial IoT. It will be a one-hour session with around 40 to 45 minutes for the presentation and the remaining time for the Q&A. So if you have any questions, please send them to us using the questions tab on the GoToWebinar control panel. I'm Sabha, the moderator of this session, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to our guest speaker, Mr. Piyush Jain. Piyush is co-founder of Axelta Systems. He has more than 20 plus years of experience and is from IIT Roorkee. He is passionate about creating unique solutions and products for Indian market. Axelta Systems has trained more than 3,500 plus people globally. So without any further delay, let me introduce you all to our guest speaker. Over to you, Piyush.
Hi. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Sabha. And good afternoon, everybody, and thanks for attending this webinar on Industrial IoT 4.0. So I'm sure many of you would have heard about Industrial IoT and are curious to know what it is all about. So in this webinar, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you to understand what is Industrial IoT 4.0 and then also talk a little bit about what all possibilities are there for you in Industrial IoT 4.0 and any questions and things you have related to maybe Industrial IoT 4.0, the technology that is going to be used in Industrial IoT 4.0, or about your career in Industrial IoT and what you can do about it. All those questions you can type in your question panel, and I'll answer all of them, you know, towards the end of this session. Okay, so now, so let me now move on and let me start the session. So Axelta, you know, our website is axelta.com. So we are an IoT startup. We are based out of Hyderabad, India. And luckily for us, we have been recognized as one of the top IoT startups in India by Economic Times, by CIO Review Magazine and Silicon India. We also are the world's largest IoT education company today, having trained, as Sabha was saying earlier, more than, you know, roughly around 4,000 people worldwide in IoT space. We have also got our own solutions and products in the IoT space and several Fortune 500 clients for the same. So this initiative about taking these webinars on IoT education is because of our interest in, you know, spreading IoT knowledge, because we believe it's the profession of the future. We also have, through our ecosystem, IoT ecosystem, more than 10,000 professionals connected worldwide with us in the IoT space. So moving on, this is my brief profile. I've worked, you know, like a traditional IT guy, worked across different companies. Lived in US for a brief time in between, like roughly 6 years, before I moved back to India in 2003. And it's in 2013 that we started Axelta, me and my partner, Manish Agarwal. So we both are from IIT Roorkee, have known each other for more than 20 plus years. And, you know, it has been a great journey for us, going from being like any other, you know, like any other employee of an organization to starting our own organization. You know, we definitely have loved the journey over the last 4 years. It has been full of passion and surprises and also, you know, great achievements for us. Moving on, this is a brief, you know, just to tell you that these are the brief list of our clients. We have several training clients. We have several now solutions and consulting clients in the product space where, or in the solution space where we are building several solutions for companies like Pidilite, KPMG, Outspace, Coca-Cola India, Spice Telecom and stuff like that. So we also have, as I said, online trainings where we have trained more than 2,500 people worldwide. And we also have a program called Tiger Kids, which we launched around 4 months back, which is for, you know, technology enabling our children, which is on the franchise mode. And we already have 10 franchisees for the same. So moving on from here, let us, you know, understand what is IoT first, very quickly in the next 2-3 minutes, and then we'll get into Industrial IoT. Okay, so imagine this is a factory, okay, and in that there are several machines, several motors and pumps which are working in this industry. Now, I want to make them IoT enabled, okay. So one of the first concepts in, you know, making something IoT enabled, essentially when you talk about IoT, let me talk like this, that when you talk about IoT, you talk about making something smart or making something intelligent, just like us human beings, right? So like we have, each one of us has a unique identity, right? Like my name is Piyush Jain, I live in Hyderabad at a particular address. So somebody, anybody in the world can uniquely identify me. Similarly, when you talk about IoT, each and every component in this industry, like every pump, every motor that you want to IoT enable, or in other words, make smart, needs to have a unique identity, which will typically, you know, in future would be, you know, IPv6. If you have heard, I'll just, you know, maybe type in that word. I don't know whether you can see, but IPv6, many of you would have heard. It's a new breed of IP addresses. And also each of these devices or things like motors, pumps, you want to make smart, we'll put in a lot of sensors in them. And also we will enable them to communicate to the outside world using protocols like Bluetooth, Bluetooth Low Energy. You know, if you have heard about NB-IoT, you know, Narrowband IoT, or LoRa networks, which is low range, basically. And also if you've heard about companies like Sigfox, Tata Communications in India, for example, is launching a, you know, is launching communication channels using LoRaWAN networks, which will enable these machines, you know, to communicate their data to the outside world. Okay, and this data could be directly communicated to the cloud or could be communicated via gateways, typically via gateways to the cloud. So gateway is a device which could be a smartphone also, because smartphone knows how to communicate using Bluetooth low energy, right? So these things can maybe use a supervisor's smartphone or a smartphone devoted for this purpose, which then processes this information, passes to a cloud-based thing, or this information could be, you know, there could be gateways which are installed. There are several gateways which are available in the market. Like there is a gateway called Android gateways which are available, which again use Android technology, but know how to communicate to these motors and pumps and machines on one side, you know, and take the data from them, like whatever parameters you want to transfer, using technologies like Bluetooth Energy, ZigBee, Z-Wave, several such low-range communication protocols, and then pass them on to a cloud-based system, which you are also calling it ERP of things. If you have heard about ERP, like SAP, Oracle, you know, PeopleSoft, these are all ERP platforms, right? Similarly, for devices or things like motors, pumps, etc., which you want to manage, which you are calling node or devices, then this software resides on a cloud, which is able to communicate to these motors and take data from them. So millions of these machines, you know, like this factory has, let's say, 100 pumps and motors. Okay, so they will be able to communicate. Then there are tens of thousands of such factories spread all over the world. You know, all of them can start communicating to this cloud-based system, you know, this ERP of things or device management software, which is residing here on a cloud, okay, using, you know, 2G, 3G, 4G communication or Wi-Fi channels of communication, or, you know, there could be satellite communication, any such channel can be used. And protocols typically use are HTTP, REST over HTTP or MQTT. And the data gets stored here in big data base, because now data is coming from, you know, tens of thousands of millions of pumps and motors. So the data becomes very huge. So it needs to be stored in a big database. Okay, so this is where a lot of analytics and other things are done in big database to generate value out of this IoT system that you are seeing right in front of you. Okay, so this is a very, you know, brief explanation of IoT. And if you see this line that I have drawn here, everything above this line, like what kind of analytics to be done, what kind of sensors, like what sensor will go in a pump, what sensors will go in a turbine maybe, what sensors will go in a motor, or a lathe machine, or any such machine which is being used, you know, or turbines, or even if you have things like boilers and blast furnaces and stuff like that. So chemical reaction machines, all of them will have sensors. And what kind of sensors to put in is also very specific to the business, very domain specific. So knowledge about the kind of sensors or what kind of analytics to do on them to derive value out of it is domain specific. Okay. And everything below this line that you see, what kind of gateway to use to communicate, what protocols to use, what cloud system you want to store your data in. If you've heard about cloud systems like ThingWorx or IoT Azure from Microsoft Stable, or if you've heard about, you know, GE Predix or IBM Bluemix, all these are examples of ERP of Things software. Accelta has its own ERP of Things software called Osmosis, okay, which is also installed on a cloud-based system, okay, which has a big database ability to store data in it. Okay. So I hope you got some idea about what a IoT system is. And also you see the reverse arrows everywhere. So you can also control things. So for example, if a turbine is working here and it starts giving too much vibration, let's say, okay, the vibration is more than usual. So then the vibrations, some sensor will detect that and pass that information to a cloud-based system. Maybe there some analysis will be done and it will be figured out that, yes, there is some issue in the turbine and it should not vibrate so much. So immediately a message might go back to the turbine saying shut down till we repair you, or a message might go to the management and other people also. So this is a typical IoT system, okay, which is being used globally. Industrial IoT, as you can see on my screen, is all about these four or five things that I'm going to discuss now. First, I'm just going to briefly go over it, and then I'll, you know, go through slides which will have each of these points explained to a little bit more, you know, to a little bit more extent, because we have very limited time. Okay. So industrial IoT is about, as the slide suggests, visibility, and, you know, first of all, you have to make the data from the machines visible. Till now in industry, the data is visible only to a supervisor who is standing there, right? Maybe some machines right next to that, some data is visible, but bulk of the data is not even captured as of now, okay? Or it is captured and it is used only locally. It doesn't go anywhere else, okay? So first thing about industrial IoT is to capture the data, from your, you know, machine parameters data, like the speed of a motor, the temperature of the motor body, the power consumption of the motor, the vibrations which are happening, even the noise levels of the motor, right? The power consumption of the motor. Similarly, you can have in furnaces, temperature of the furnace, the gas pressure of the furnace, in boiler, the gas pressure or the steam pressure and stuff like that. You know, presses, the pressure being applied on by the moving arm of the presses. How many, what is the tools, for example, like, you know, these are dies and stuff. What, how many cycles have been done in a tool? Okay, because every tool will have limited life. What is the wear and tear which is happening on the surface of the tool? In presses, what is the wear and tear happening? How much power consumption, body temperatures? All these parameters talk up somewhere about the machine as well as the characteristics of the machine, right? The output. So all that is machine data, and I'm just listing some of the things. There are several other parameters which are very scientific in nature, which you, again, to get those parameters, what parameter to capture, all domain specific. So a motor person who has worked on motor domain for years will know much better than me what kind of data to capture, right? So you have to talk to the domain person. That is very critical here. Another kind of data could be asset tracking data, like, you know, your vehicle tracking data, you know, inventory tracking data, your tool tracking data. So some of these tools which are used in industry are, you know, each tool, sometimes these tools cost 50 lakh rupees, crore rupees per tool. Okay, so you have to keep tracking them so that you don't lose them, or you don't make a new one while you still have the old one there. Like workforce tracking, where is the current person, in which area of the factory? Some of these factories are spread over kilometers, right? So how to track a person, his hours of working, or hours of, you know, working relevantly for the job? Many of the such things can be captured using asset tracking. Inventory, you know, as you understand, you know, I repeated it here, inventory tracking, to track the inventory levels real time, every time, right? Production data, how much production is happening right now in the industry. Many times management gets a day old, 2 day old data, which might be very late, right? You need to have this instance data, and so that you can take action instantly, right? So such things are very much possible using IoT. Quality control data, for example, we recently visited a factory in which tiles are being manufactured. So what are the number of tiles being manufactured? And what is the, you know, how many defective tiles are getting manufactured? You know, we can figure out the defects on the tile by judging the contrast, the cracks which are there, or the texture of the tile. And we are able to tell how many tiles are getting defective and what is the reason for it also. So you can also control the reasons for it and prevent that from happening, right? Energy data, consumption of power, wattage. You know, why should I run a machine which consumes my maximum power during peak hours when the power rates are high, right? So companies or industries are being offered power in peak rates and non-peak rates, okay? Excuse me, I think my connection got lost or something. Okay, so I'm back. I think my connection got lost in between for a second. Sure. So, I hope you guys are able to hear me. Sure. So basically, you know, tracking all the data which is there in the industry. Now you have also have real-time monitoring and dashboards. So you have, you know, once you have got the data, you have got to represent it to the management in a proper way, right? You have to create dashboards, mobile-based dashboards, system-based dashboards, you know, pad-based dashboards, which can detect and display the data which you are capturing in the right way to the management. Okay, that's the first step. Again, an important first step in IoT. You know, you have to have real-time triggers and alarms for different conditions. Like I mentioned earlier, that a turbine is generating a lot of noise, or the power consumption suddenly of the turbine has increased, or the body temperature of the turbine has increased. Any of these conditions means there's something seriously wrong with that machine. So I need to immediately communicate back that thing either to directly to the turbine and ask it to shut down. But if I know there might be other elite processes which might get impacted, then I would, you know, kind of pass that information to the supervisors, managers and stuff, and get it reported. We can generate any sort of reports which are required by management, by consumers, by users, you know, by supervisors, you know, how the machine performed over time, what are the defects, how the defect varied over time, what caused some of these things, all those kinds of real-time dashboards and reports can be done in industrial IoT. Data integration with backend systems, again, very important. For example, you know, you get an order of some particular numbers, right? But that order, and my production targets are already set, but that order is bigger than my production targets, right? So that information can automatically be fed into my systems, IoT systems, through my IoT systems to the supervisor saying, because you need to increase the production. Or, you know, if suppose there is some workflows which get processed in your company, for example, once the something is built, then it has to be shipped, right? So when something is built right now, you know, some supervisor will go and manually count things, how many have been built, and accordingly enter into your backend system saying so many pieces built, you know, start the workflow for shipping them out or maintaining them or do something with it, right? But then now no need to do that. The data inputs which are going to come into your systems, you know, are typically in your backend systems are going to come from real-time IoT, basically. So that's a major criteria that is going to change. Not only the management is going to get the data, but many much of the data, like inventory data, power consumption data, quality data, production data, all that is required by your ERP systems, right? To configure and workflows are triggered based on certain activities. All those things need to be integrated back. So a lot of work in software needs to happen, where all your, you know, SAPs and industrial MES systems, PLM systems, some defect is happening, design needs to change, data needs to go to the PLM system. So all those cycles, you know, are going to work automatically by real-time data with integration backend systems. Okay, then we come to predictive maintenance. So these are like machine predicting, machine failures, accident prevention, defect prevention, and optimal usage of resources. All these are basically, you know, just a second, guys. Yeah, all these are basically predictive things you can do. I'll talk in detail about them a little bit from now. Okay, so the prospects of IoT, IIoT are huge. Before I get into anything else, just let me you know, tell you that this is going to be the biggest opportunity, both in terms of industrial activity, as well in terms of job, as well in terms of capital, you know, investments and profit earned. You know, it's going to be like a $10 trillion opportunity for the global economy within the next 10-12 years. We're not talking about, you know, 50 years from now, we're talking about 10 years. It's going to be $10 trillion. It's already hitting $1 trillion. So people are saying this 10 trillion is an underestimation. It's going to become like $20 to $30 trillion, okay, in the next few years. And because of this, you know, there'll be a surge of demand for IoT talent, 300% in the next few years. We're talking about 300,000 IoT jobs in the next coming years. And that's why we are also launching an IoT training, you know, where people can get trained in industrial Internet of Things to improve their job prospects. Okay, so now coming back to that slide about industrial IoT, first topic was machine data. Okay, so you can see real-time data collection. Okay, and it's just not about, you know, helping manufacturers improve their productivity and profitability. Essentially, we want to make things data-driven. You know, data is the key economic superpower, you can say, of the future. And things have to be data-driven. So what is actually happening on the ground should be the key decision maker, you know, should trigger the key decision makings basically. Okay, I am getting so much production today. So do I need to increase production now or do I need to reduce production now? I'm getting so much defects right now. So what do I need to do to that particular machine or process to improve it? You know, so all my decision making has to become based on real-time data rather than some guesses or experience and stuff like that, right? So that is where IoT is going to take us. So right now, data collection and monitoring, as I said earlier, you know, to be able to quickly analyze and act upon these things is the key for making any decisions in industry that you need to make. And most industries that we are working with now are looking for this, because this is what we're going to give them that, you know, because many huge competition is there, like car manufacturing industry, huge competition, very little margins, electronics industry, very little margins, right? This additional small things, you know, which look small, by the way, but they are not small, but getting that additional data as a base input will reduce the losses, will reduce the things with, you know, so much effect that, you know, it will lead to that small increase in profitability, which will essentially, you know, make you much more competitive than others and beat your competition, basically. Okay, so that's where industrial IoT is. And this is just a diagrammatic flow where, you know, data from machines, you know, using gateways is captured and getting displayed in different dashboards and stuff. I said tracking data. As I said earlier, you can track, you know, your fleet. So in any, for example, we are right now working with a company, very large, you know, chemical manufacturer. It's a fleet of hundreds of trucks and, you know, containers, basically, which move around, you know, entire India, basically. So how do we, but they don't have that much information. Once the truck leaves the factory premises, where it is, why it is taking, you know, why there's a delay, why the truck didn't reach on time to the client, then there was material got spoiled or something like that. You know, all those questions can be answered by having a collective fleet where you can do location tracking, and you can also figure out whether vehicles are being fully utilized or not. You know, this could be a very important decision making for your capex, whether you want to buy more vehicles or not. You know, so my fleet performance parameters, you know, can really, really, you know, these are very expensive things and can really help, you know, add that additional, you know, additional cost reduction that I need. So real-time tracking of inventory, you know, asset health, utilization of inventory, utilization of assets, you know, all those things are very much possible using IoT. Workforce management, as I said earlier, tracking of workforce, you know, workloads per person, work orders, whether the work orders are given, whether that work order is being acted upon or not, what is the timesheet data, capturing the timesheet data, you know, data docs, which capture the order workflow, you know, and progress of work, basically. All that could be based on milestones or based on, you know, triggers, which IoT triggers, saying that, okay, this particular workforce has done this particular work in this much time, and this is the output, right? So those output could be critical milestones, which could be tracked using IoT. And those outputs can directly be fed into your workforce management systems, rather than some person going there and entering saying this work order completed and this work order now going to start, which leads to, you know, corruption, human delays, and you know, people favoring somebody and stuff like that. Now those things can be done automatically using IoT, and that data can be pushed directly into those systems, which is much more authenticated and reliable, and you know, so that your decision making can be that much more better. So workforce management could be taken to the next level using IoT. Energy consumption, again, as I mentioned earlier, you know, monitoring your and managing your energy consumption. Energy is one of the biggest expenses, especially in India, right? Huge expense for industry. Also, the reliability of energy is a huge expense. So, for example, today, these days, energy producers, government is kind of supplying energy, let's say. They are saying there's a peak time and there's a non-peak time. And peak time is typically like evening times or maybe office timings or whatever. And they are like, you know, where the rates of electricity are higher. So why should I run my most power-hungry equipment, you know, when that time is there? I should run that equipment when less billing is there or cheaper power is available, right? So IoT can definitely help you manage that in a much better way. Imagine you have tens of thousands of jobs in a huge factory which run one after the other and in some sequences and all that. All that you can configure, design workflows for them, and make sure that they run in a proper sequence and all that without having to really do it, you know, manually. right, which saves in terms of, you know, reducing the errors and losses and stuff like that. It also leads to huge power savings. Okay, power can account for almost 10, 20, 30% of, depending on type of industry, how much, you know, the cost of the final product. So that can be saved up to the extent of, I'm hearing cases where it can be saved up to the extent of 30, 40% reduction in power consumption using some of these monitoring and control mechanisms which are coming out. So you can essentially optimally use your resources and save a lot of power, right? Now, with the data, you can also get the quality control data, as I mentioned earlier, right? So not only you can get the data, you can do quality correct actions also. So for example, that tile manufacturing company that we went to, we can figure out, okay, how many, you know, tiles are getting damaged and why they are getting damaged. Once we have that loop closed, you know, as soon as we start detecting that error, we can trigger actions which can take care of that error. Or at least inform people that, you know, this error is happening, the tiles are getting defective. Please control this parameter urgently. Right? This is already happening to a certain extent in some large corporates. But then much of the quality control is only based on local inputs. Now you can, because you, once you have data from lots many factories, you can do analysis and figure out much more accurate ways of detecting as well as controlling errors. Okay, so that is also one of, you can do a lot of, you know, control of defects and defect monitoring using IoT and take corrective actions. Dashboards, as I said earlier, you know, the idea is to showcase this data to your management, right? Without the management come to know about it, what's the point, right? So that's where, you know, you have these dashboards like mobile. Typically, things are moving to mobile and pads and stuff like that. So you have these real-time triggers and alarms. Like some level reaches 64%, inform somebody, something happens 6%, inform somebody, shut down something, restart something. All those triggers and alarms, keeping everybody in loop, you know, using mobile-based dashboards and stuff and emails and SMSs, call-based systems, all those things are possible. And things can be managed in a much better way. Right, real time, hourly, daily, weekly, all sorts of reports can be done automatically and triggered to respective people. You know, a lot of integration with backend system, as I mentioned earlier. Look, for example, we are working for a logistics company where a truck needs to go and pick up stuff and deliver it to some other place. Right now, when a truck starts its journey, right now, what happens? The driver of the truck will call the supervisor saying, "I'm starting my journey." Supervisor will enter into their fleet management system saying, "The truck journey started." Let's say the journey is 30 hours. The driver needs to be changed after 15 hours. So once that person enters, then only the other person gets informed that the other driver gets informed that, okay, be available on that location after 15 hours. This guy is going to come and replace him. Now this truck gets delayed by 10 hours. No way of telling. That guy has to call him. Now he doesn't know who is driving this truck this time. So many logistics issues are there. Right? Now, with IoT-enabled trucks, the truck starts the journey, GPS informs. The automated system saying truck has started the journey. Automatic messaging goes out to the concerned people that this particular truck having this driver, contact information, has started the journey, you know, and right now at this location. The other truck driver also can complete his other works. And then once he knows, okay, this truck has reached, is nearing this location, then only he goes. You know, he can real-time track and all that. So all that leads to small savings per truck, which can collate to a huge database. Right, so a lot of such systems are coming out, which are leading to, you know, huge savings for companies. And integrating live data with backend systems is a huge work which is opening up for Indian IT industry also. So live data integration between production and ERP, manufacturing, supply chain, asset management, CRM systems, huge integration, sales service system. Where is the sales guy right now? When he checks in a new order, the information should he reach a supervisor who is into manufacturing directly. Right, and that guy should confirm whether he can meet that order or not. Right, rather than that information coming into a database, sitting there for 5 days, then traveling to somebody else, all real time, right on time kind of system. Sales guy can check, what are my production levels today right now? Okay, this order which is coming, should I schedule it in a different way right now with the client? Or should I immediately accept the order because production is able to handle it? Many of these questions will start becoming automated and real time without involving, you know, supervisors and managers and all those people, will happen automatically. So, you know, very, very smooth functioning of businesses, basically, much more customer satisfaction. Okay, so finding out quality control failures and all that, as I already said. Okay, so another big point in IoT is predictive analysis and management. So we are headed towards predictive. Right now, I will say only very few predictive, you know, things have been managed in IoT because the data is not there. Okay, only now for the last 1 or 2 years, the data has started collecting, okay, which will enable us to do predictive. For example, as I mentioned earlier, you know, there are pumps and motors. So this industry which you went to, there are thousands of pumps and motors. Okay, any pump or motor going bad at any point of time, imagine it is pumping some chemical into some reaction vessel. And there are 10 other pumps pumping some chemicals into that reaction motor. Now, one of those pumps right at that time gets bad, is not able to pump, or pumps more or less, right? What happens that other chemicals keep coming in, the entire lot gets spoiled. You know, that entire lot might have to be thrown away. Huge losses for the company, right? If I'm able to figure out that this pump is about to break down, okay, or this pump has started generating this issue, and in the next 2 months it's going to fail, let me schedule a maintenance for it. Okay, so those kind of predictive maintenance can make a huge impact in the industry. Okay, your aircraft engines, GE for example, is fixing, you know, aircraft engines with more than 3,000 sensors now. It's collecting all the data. I was reading an article which said that every day a GE gas or a wind turbine generates a terabyte of data. A terabyte, okay. So now imagine once you have the data for a couple of years from thousands of such turbines, GE is working on a system where aircraft engine failure or a turbine failure will become history, basically. Until some physical impact happens, it's not going to fail. Okay, why? Because proactively we'll be able to figure out that, okay, this particular turbine blade has developed this particular erosion on the blade surface, which might develop into a crack and an engine failure, you know, 3 months from now. So let me proactively maintain it, okay, and fix it. And how do I come to know about it? First, by measuring the surface itself. But forget about that. You know, it could be also done by measuring the power consumption patterns, the noise levels, the vibration levels, the output that you are getting from it, the pressures of things inside, you know, how the flow happens and stuff. You know, you can get, there are a lot of complex physical models and algorithms which will help you figure out. So those models require a lot of data to process, right? And right now what's happening in the industry, a lot of data is getting collected. Okay, companies have started investing. Those companies which are investing will start seeing results, although little bit results have started trickling out. But the real results will start trickling out, you know, maybe a year or a couple of years from now, when suddenly one day companies realize, okay, my motors used to fail after 5 years. This is the reason for it. So I can repair it now. You know, I can put sensors which can trigger actions, you know, 3 months in advance. So a lot of savings can happen, right? So lower risk, asset life and availability increases hugely. Loss of service decreases, labor and operation cost reduces. So you know this thing has to be maintained. So I can schedule a maintenance for it, right? I don't need to do, so suppose it fails right now, then I have to go for ad hoc maintenance because I need it repaired now. I'm ready to pay twice the cost. Huge expenses incurred by company because of ad hoc maintenance. Now if I can schedule the maintenance much better, much less cost, right? So very decrease, you know, huge decrease in unplanned maintenance and planned maintenance also, because, you know, I know exactly when the thing is. So right now my motor is working perfectly fine and IoT is telling me there is nothing wrong with this motor. So why should I have a planned maintenance also, right? I should delay it by 6 months. Why should I pay extra when machine is working fine, right? Typically 90% case it will be like that. So huge decrease in planned and huge decrease in unplanned maintenance. Reduce required compliance, you know, much smarter, basically, replacement and inspection, where you will inspect it in a much smarter way based on data and then correct it, right? So monitoring actual equipment condition, you know, and making an informed decision is what you're talking about here. So you actually reduce unplanned downtime by 3 to 5%, you know, and against total availability. So your, you know, mean time to repair and mean time between repair kind of parameters, which are important parameters for, you know, machine maintenance, definitely reduce or increase depending on what they are. And your overall equipment effectiveness definitely increases heavily. You know, you get like, you know, in a normal factory, you have it around 75-80%, becomes like 90% almost. Maintenance costs reduced by 13% year on year. You know, this number looks 13% can translate into millions and even billions of dollars in some cases. Huge numbers. Return on assets up by 24%. Can you imagine the kind of numbers we are talking about here? Right. In, you know, predicting failures in time can lead to all these things which are there. You can fault recognition of specific assembled operations, you know, you can 97% time you can detect that. And we can 97% time, we can predict delays and cancellations. And that too 12 weeks in advance. You know, that's the level we can reach with the IoT. You know, 85% accuracy, predictive pipeline, you know, stuck pipelines and stuff like that. Because as the pipeline starts getting stuck, you know, there are initial signs of it. Pressure increases, speed increases, pressure decreases and stuff like that. Right? So you can definitely predict that there is some blockage happening. So what kind of blockage is there? What levels of blockage I can bear in my industry? Only then I repair it. You know, not only it's about repairing it right now, it's also about delaying the repair till I can manage so that my cost decreases. Right? Inventories can decrease, unplanned maintenance decreases hugely. Overall production life productivity increases, operating efficiencies go down, you know, warranty claims, processing time decreases. Now that you have data with you, you know, you can claim and you can claim with data. This is what exactly happened. So there is nobody can deny your claims, right? OPEX budget decreases by 10 to 15%. Huge decrease in OPEX budget. So huge impact overall in the machines. And you have these dashboards which say, you know, optimal usage of resources. And you can do all your resources. You can monitor real time, every time on your desktops and laptops and mobile phones. Typically, your supervisors, you know, all need to have mobile phones. All already have mobile phones, smartphones, right? You can just use that to exactly know their area where it is, rather than having a huge dashboard in one huge room like you see in movies, right, where all the machines are visible and some 10 people sitting there maintaining. You know, each machine can maintain itself by telling its parameters, and each supervisor will be there to monitor his area, right? So giving power to the people who are directly deployed there and making machines intelligent, you know, so that they can themselves tell whether I'm right or wrong is what we are talking about in industrial IoT. Okay, which can, as you can know, will lead to huge benefits for the industry. And as I said earlier, $10 to $30 trillion business in the next 10 to 13 years. So it's not very far away. And we are already seeing $1 trillion worth of business in 2017-18 itself. Okay, and this business is going to multiply, become like 10 times in 10-12 years. So you can imagine the growth rate is like 35-40%. Okay. So we at Axelta have a consulting approach. We help industries become IoT enabled. We start with education where we can teach you what IoT can do for you in much more in-depth courses we have built. Okay, where you can see what all advantages and disadvantages you can do. We can bring a domain flavor also in that based on your domains. We will consult you. Then if we get into that, then we'll consult you on which area you can focus on right now as a first step. We can do a POC for you so that you can see the value add. And then we can get into projects and solutions. So this approach Axelta has taken multiple times with companies. And this is where we are, you know, really doing a lot of business, a lot of, you know, large companies in India. And we are some of the technologies that we deal with. You know, we can, any sort of language, any sort of protocol, a lot of hardwares. We have huge expertise in all these things to be able to build a complete, comprehensive, end-to-end IoT solution for your industry. Right, right from educating you to delivering a solution. You know, we cover end-to-end in Axelta, and this is the roadmap that we use. Analyze, develop POC, do a pilot, and then final rollout. So this is what we do in Axelta. Also in education, which is the first step, you know, we have a lot of trainings which lead you to this. So we have, like, you know, boot camps, which are the starting points for you to understand IoT. And many of these things are online and physical in corporates, okay? So anybody can do. You know, you can just visit axelta.com and, you know, and figure out. So Axelta is A-X-E-L-T-A, by the way. It's a difficult spelling. But then you can do our trainings. We have a solution architect course, which we are launching, you know, on 15th of August, where we will do comprehensive training. Anybody wants to become like a solution architect, so you are a domain expert, or you are a IoT, IT expert, or you are a, you know, hardware expert, or a, you know, some protocol expert, or you know some area in industry or IT industry or anything, you know, right now is the time to get into IoT space. And we kind of do an IoT solution architect course where we'll teach you all these things. And in like 3 to 4 or 6 months, again, it could be online or physical, including practicals, okay, that we can do online also and physically also. So we have a lot of things, and we do a lot of college trainings also. Kind of is a franchise program. We just launched it 3 months back. We already have it in 5 cities and 10 franchisees, you know, to make our children tax-savvy. Anybody interested in doing something like tax can also approach us. So we are available at excelta.com website, or you can mail us at corporate@excelta.com. Okay? And definitely we can help, you know, answer your queries or build your career and stuff like that. Okay? So you can keep typing in your questions. I think many people, or some people at least, have typed in your questions. So let me now try and answer some of the questions. So let me now undock. Okay, so there are some questions. So is IoT and machine learning connected? It is from Deepak. Very good question, Deepak. So see, IoT is the overall umbrella. IoT is not a technology. Okay, IoT is a concept, a solution approach, you can say. Inside the IoT solution approach, there are huge number of, you know, technologies or huge number of different options which are there. For example, is something on sensors, which from which IoT starts, right? And then you have communication protocols, both low range and long range. And then you have hardware, which is about, you know, physical gateways and physical things which do the communication and which connect to sensors, take data from sensors, send it to a cloud-based system. The cloud-based system, you have an ability to take data, store it in a big data system and stuff like that, right? So just a second, let me extend this window because a lot of questions are there. Okay, right. So machine learning is a part of the big data analytics piece, which resides in the cloud-based system. Okay, so you have to do machine learning is about what? Okay, my parts have started coming in defective. Okay, so my machine is learning that, or my system is learning that my parts start coming defective. You know, some this pattern is there which makes it defective. That when a new lot is added in the afternoon session, when my furnace is already hot, let's say, and then because of, you know, whatever reasons, my lot started having more defects than when, you know, in the morning batch of production. So then that's where machine learning comes into the picture, where your systems will learn that, okay, why that happens. So then some people will start analyzing this data and figure out, or machines will learn that, okay, my furnace needs to be cooled down. Then only this system needs to start again, right? So machines, you know, will learn because of the data which keeps coming in. You know, the systems will learn. And then they will start doing the things accordingly. So there will be the next batch which is going to be loaded. The next batch will get this, you know, delayed a little bit till the furnace is cool. And then only the data will get loaded, right? So definitely machine learning is a part of IoT, a subset of IoT, you can say. So how in small time we can show benefit or POC to show management the value of IoT? Very good question, Tarun. So definitely you can show value in this, but the small time means what? It will depend on the use case. Okay, we have done use cases or implemented use cases in as little as 3 weeks. So we have a complete ecosystem. We have team here. We have almost got a, you know, 45-50 member team now, where we have a team which will look at what kind of sensors to use, or we can take input from domain people on that. We have a cloud-based system. We have a gateways to pass data to a cloud-based system. On the cloud-based system, we have an ability to do rules engine, analyze the data, do some action back. We can push the action back to the machine to shut it down, speed it up, or do some changes on the machine, right? So we have a built-in ecosystem with several parts already there. Your use case can be fitted into that with a little bit of customization. Of course, some costs are involved, right? It cannot be done without cost. But then, it's a small time and small cost. POCs can be done. Of course, depends on the use case. If it's a very, very different, unique use case, it might be a little bit longer. But we have done as it is in 3 weeks. And definitely in 6 to 10 weeks, we can definitely do a lot of things. Okay. So is automation industry similar to IoT? Automation has been industry, Ashok, from last, you know, 40, 50, even 60 years. Since when the T model from Ford was launched, automation is there, right, in 1920 or 30. What I'm saying is automation has been there. Automation is IoT, nobody would call it IoT, right? IoT is much more than automation. It's about taking decisions intelligently. So a machine comes to know that I'm vibrating too much today. Passe hai, and then it takes an action, it forms a supervisor. So for supervisor, the message will come on his phone. It's coming from the cloud or it's coming from the gateway or the machine, they don't know. right? But the message will come saying this particular machine is making two extra decibel or 10 extra decibel of sound. Last time when that happened, the machine failed in 3 days. Please get it maintained now. Okay, so machine is telling the supervisor this thing. Machine is telling the supervisor that my temperature has become more than what it should be right now. You know, because of this reason, please correct me. Right? So, or I'm taking this action and correcting myself. Right? So this is much more than automation. This is much more about taking sensible decisions based on data. Okay. And internet is an integral part of it. You cannot have all that data knowledge built on the machine itself. You have to take the data somewhere, merge it with the previous existing huge amounts of data, then take an action somewhere. Right? And all those things you can learn. We have a, you know, analytics program also in Excelta, IoT and analytics, you know, and which can really teach you about automation. You know, how IoT is different, analytics is different than automation, much more than that. Okay. There's a question from Anand which says, given an industrial environment, generally the last mile connectivity medium will be Wi-Fi. Where do you see telco's role from a SIM perspective? No, it's not going to be Wi-Fi generally, right? In a home automation, it's going to be Wi-Fi. In industrial automation, LoRaWAN, you know, low bandwidth, or you can say it's basically long range. LoRa stands for long range, and it's basically uses a protocol which allows it to communicate up to a 2 to 3 kilometer distance. So factories, some of these factories are 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers long, right? Recently, we have implemented LoRa in one of the factories, okay, which can allow the device to communicate with the smart switch almost half a kilometer away. Okay, so last mile connectivity is going to be much more about LoRa and NB, narrow band IoT. Okay, or telecommunication is launching, for example, in India, LoRa. Okay, they launched already in 5 cities. In Hyderabad right now, the implementation is going on. Okay, so a lot of telecom companies are getting into that machine data collection, you know, and offering services of its own. So Tata Communication, for example, is offering services of its own, which are built on top of LoRa, okay, which will allow companies to achieve something. All right. So that's how, you know, telecom companies cannot just remain within telecom. They have to start offering value adds on top of it. That's where these things come out. Okay. And we have a specific session for corporates, which is about, you know, how corporates can use IoT, power of IoT, basically, especially in the telecom domain. Okay, so we have a 1 day or a 2 day workshop that we can do, Anand. Harsh is saying, can you tell us how can IoT is useful for artificial intelligence area? I already explained that in quite some detail, Harsh. So I think you must have got the idea by now that once you get the data with you, then you have a lot much more power to do a lot of things. So Madan is asking a question. There are a lot many questions. Let me go quickly through this. How much you are charging for IoT solution architect? So that charges you can discuss, Madan. Depends on your level. Well, depends on what you are doing, okay, and depends on how you want to, you know, what value we see, and then we can, you know, do that. You can credit us with us. You can mail us at corporate, I'm just typing in, at excelta.com, you know, and we can answer your questions. Okay, what all the other technologies required to learn this? So see, technology-wise, IoT, as I said, is an umbrella of technologies. You know, it's a solution approach which has a lot of technologies which can help. You have Java developers. You have protocol like ZigBee, Z-Wave, you know, Bluetooth, LoRaWAN developers. A lot of technology people, protocol people, hardware developers. A lot of people who understand sensors. A lot of people who understand cloud-based systems, you know, deploying applications on a cloud, developing those cloud-based applications. Developing integration between these cloud-based applications and SAP systems of the world, which are in the back end. So if you know SAP, you know Oracle, you know PeopleSoft, you know Microsoft systems, you know, then you will be in demand because all of these IoT systems need to be getting integrated. So you have to understand IoT for that. Okay. So you should understand IoT first. And for that, we have things like IoT bootcamp and stuff which you can do. How can one proceed to undergo such training sessions? You can just connect with us. At corporate, you can visit our website at, you know, excelta.com, or you can visit us as, you know, corporate at, one second, guys. So you like to switch domain from mechanical design engineer to other domain. Is it possible? Definitely. So all the people who are in some domain, you know, you need no need to lose heart at all. IoT is not about creating something unique without you. It's about using your existing knowledge, developing knowledge on Internet of Things after that, and then getting into IoT. Okay, so again, as I said, you can visit our website or you can go to corporateaccelerator.com, mail us at corporateaccelerator.com, we can help you. How to build IoT using technology? So I already answered that. What are the use cases of IoT in data science? Yeah, see, every domain will have use case. Saurabh, you know, this is a very generic question, cannot be answered, you know, so simply. But as I said, there are some use cases, like I said about motors and pumps or GE building systems for gas turbines, right? A pressure boiler being monitored using IoT, you know, motor telling that I'm getting bad, please repair me, or am I about to fail in another 24 hours, please repair me now. You know, these are all big data science IoT use cases. So security aspects one must consider when deploying AI. Very, very correct, Anand, very good question. Security aspects are one key aspect. So all these protocols that I talked about, MQTT, ZigBee, Z-Wave, you know, all of them have their own security, like man in the middle, data encryption, frequency hopping, right? So typically at the edge points where data hops from one system to the other, which when it's in air and vulnerable, is when people will try to. So using HTTPS, you know, secured socket layer communication, using encryption, using frequency hopping mechanisms, you know, all these things will help you get your system robust and ahead of people who try to hack into your systems. So we are also launching a course on IoT security within the next month or so, by September. Okay, so that I will talk in detail about how different systems can be secured. Okay, we are already building that program right now, so along with a partner of ours. So, you know, you can look at that maybe. Is it possible to design an IoT on home appliances? Definitely. You know, huge amount of work happening on that side. In fact, we in Excelta have developed some products on that side also. So you can get in touch with us, but definitely is it possible. You know, how IoT will help agriculture, huge use cases in agriculture opening up, you know. So anywhere there are keywords like monitoring, tracking, remote operation, okay, IoT becomes applicable, Sukhjinder. Okay, so basically, for example, recently somebody launched a, you know, a switch, okay, which is called Ganesha switch, which can be operated using your mobile phone, okay, from your home. So these, you know, farmers have these pump sets on their, you know, on their farms, and they are at home most of the time. And then, you know, the power supply only comes for 6 hours in Telangana, for example. Power only comes for 6 or 8 hours to the farm, okay, to run the motors, which is free, basically. But these farmers earlier used to keep the motor on. Power used to come, and then, you know, motor will start automatically, shut down, and the power goes. But you don't need to run the motor every day for 8 hours, right? So then you can now control that from your home itself, but because of laziness and traveling 2 kilometers just to switch on motor, they were not doing it, right? So now with IoT, you can, you know, with that switch, Ganesh switch, you can control your phone or control the motor or pump from your home, and when you want to switch it on, when you want to switch it off, basically. So automation industry is not similar to IoT, as I explained earlier, Ashok. IoT is much more than automation. Machine learning is very useful in industry 4.0 very well. That's the brain of, you know, IoT, industrial IoT, basically. But this is something which is still some way away. So I confess to that it's still some way away, because a lot of data has not come in. A lot of things have not fully matured. Now they have started doing that. So maybe in the next couple of years, you will start seeing real machine learning systems in industry also, okay, which are coming out. But then, you know, it will take some time for the actual use cases to emerge. So role of SCADA and PLC in IoT, well, they'll become obsolete. If not, then how can we make them? So right now, they're not going to become, you know, out of obsolete in the next, you know, few years. Right now, we are working to get the data out from SCADA systems and, you know, PLC and taking it to the cloud, storing it there, doing analytics on it, you know, figuring out triggers and other things to be able to control systems. Right, because now we can get data from so many machines simultaneously. The pool size increases huge. So we can have many more conditions and things identified. Right, but then role of SCADA case is going to continue in near future at least. Slowly, slowly, they might phase out. But as of now, we don't foresee that In fact, we are working with SCADA and PLC, and the industrial IoT course which we are launching, you know, is also using a SCADA system and a PLC system and an OPC server and all those things to control things. Is machine learning, so another question, role of SCADA, which technology is best preferred for IoT? So I said, IoT is not technology. Okay, IoT is an amalgamation of existing technologies. Nikhil, will completely depend on the use case that you are working on to figure out which technology is helpful. Okay, and but then as I said earlier, there is a plethora of technologies which can be used and which is being used by us. So another question, one second. I am an Oracle Apps technical developer. Is there definitely, you know, people who are working in Oracle Apps, SAP, you know, Microsoft Stack, you know, any such area, SAP, any such area, people, software, etc. Huge possibility for them to get to know IoT and then to apply it in their area. And then you just need to be in your area and learn something extra and position yourself as an IoT architect. That's why we have the Solution Architect Program, you know, which can really help you do that. So I'll suggest you get in touch with us. Okay. Artificial intelligence area, I already said, you know, there is a huge applications of it where, you know, AI basically is nothing but machines. So machine telling you, I am about to get sick in the next 24 hours or 48 hours because even if my turbines, a small crack has appeared, you know, is artificial intelligence, right? So machine, you know, all the systems around us become, you know, very much capable of doing things and maintaining them. So right now, the first step is about getting the data. Second step is about triggering actions. Third step is about generating that AI, where machines will be able to monitor themselves, track themselves, and tell us about, you know, what's happening and why the production is low, why the production is high, is all, you know, through artificial intelligence. Will you provide the real-time project? Yes, we have a lot of real-time. So we are in the IoT solutions, right? We have built a lot of IoT solutions. We have deployed them in several Fortune 500 companies. I showed you my... So with all the trainings, we'll be having real-time industrial projects. Okay. So another question. So what about processing delay in case of control module? There are definitely, you know, so, you know, in a body, for example, let me take your case of human body. So your hand touches a hot object. Okay. Immediately your hand jerks away. Right, and then later you realize that my hand has touched the hot object. Why? Because action is being taken by a spinal cord. It's called a reflex action in humans. Right, there's no time to send the data to brain, then send the reflection back to the body. Right, so that's where these systems come into the picture. What are the expected competencies required if I want to be a solution architect or a system design analyst? Yeah. So see, what you currently know, Nilesh, we need to understand that. Okay, that is a good point. Based on that only we can suggest. So if you are a hardware guy, I will not suggest you to get into Java, you know, and build. You know, there are a lot of things to do in hardware itself. If you are a software guy, then depending on which ecosystem you belong to, maybe big data analytics system, or reporting user interface system, or Android system, or a Java developer, you know, or a cloud developer, or a Python developer. There's so many areas, each one of them having a full life cycle and ability to give you job opportunity for life, basically. What accelerators are created or used by accelerator to short go? So we already have, you know, several components built in. We already have gateways. We already have cloud-based system with a lot of built-in dashboards, which can we can populate with your data. We have built in analytics also for certain use cases. We have several Android apps developed. We have ability to, you know, talk to your PLCs, you know, different brands that you have already built, right? So all those possibilities are there, etc. So all those accelerators are there, Kamal, for us to be able to very quickly. We also, you know, we have ThingWorx competency. We are official trainers for ThingWorx. Okay, so we have a competency of ThingWorx resources, which already has a lot of things built in. So we can use ThingWorx to do some of the things that you want to do on the cloud side and stuff. Okay, we also are Microsoft certified or Microsoft Silver Partner. So we have access to Microsoft products also, where we have a lot of access to a lot of their accelerators and stuff, especially on the analytics side and data side. Okay, so we have a lot of things that we can work with you. Predix is about GE. It's a GE device management software, which they are saying is devoted to industrial IoT. Okay, so Predix has, you know, GE has a system where, so we are almost nearing our time. So we have actually done the time. So are you there, Sabha? How much more time we have?
So we are
Sabha.
Already over with the time for this webinar.
Okay. Let me just take two last questions.
Sure.
Okay. Is that okay?
Sure, sure.
Okay. Let me just see where is the... What is, can you imagine, can an engineer from plant or field has a future? Definitely, Suraj, you have a huge future in IoT. You know, especially industrial IoT is just now opening up. You know, the sunlight days for people working in IoT is opening up now. Okay, so huge area opening up. So if a star is, no, it's not a star. So it's basically there are multiple nodes and multiple, I don't know what you mean by star topology, Aaron, exactly. So it's not a central failure system. You know, we have a mesh kind of things, mesh networks and stuff, or maybe star topology basically, where, you know, failovers are there, multiple channels are there, and we can, you know, help, you know, multiple channels of communication. So if anything fails, we can definitely work it around and still have information flowing. Okay, so last question I'm taking is, so if I like to switch domain from mechanical design engineer to IoT domain, is it possible to do so? See, everything is possible. Nothing is impossible. So Padmanabha is left. Let me take another question. How can one proceed to undergo such training sessions? So get into www.excelta.com. Okay, or mail us at corporate@excelta.com. Okay, and we can help you, you know, do this training. So huge amount of data is generated by industrial equipment. How do we decide on what level of analytics to be done at edge pocket? So Vijay, that will completely depend on the use case. As I said earlier, you know, it will depend on whether you need to, you know, whether you need to work on this thing, you know, your industrial IoT, or whether you need to work on, what is the use case that you have, whether your action needs to be taken immediately, or whether your action can be delayed. So we can decide based on that. So that's what we do basically. Okay. So thank you guys for your time, and over to you, Sabha.
Thank you so much, Piyush, for this really empowering and motivating session today. I would also like to thank all our participants for making this webinar a great success. This session has been recorded, and the recording will soon be available on tegig.com. Thank you, everyone, for joining us.